You're listening to the audio production of The Church of the Small Things Audio Study by Melanie Shankle, published by Zondervan. This unique listening experience contains live on-location recordings combined to create study sessions. As a result, these sessions will reflect the ambience of the unique locations where they were recorded. Presented by the author.
Some Bible study teachers traveled to Israel to teach from various places in the Holy Land where Jesus walked on earth. The Sea of Galilee, the Mount of Olives. Me, I chose Round Top, Texas, a place known for great shopping and good food and girls' weekends. It's my own little holy land. For about 48 weeks of the year, Round Top is one of the smallest incorporated towns in Texas with a population of 90 people. But for 4 weeks of the year, two in the spring, two in the fall, Round Top is the site of one of the largest antique shopping events in the country. Thousands upon thousands of treasure seekers buy and sell their way through tents and warehouses. An estimated 100,000 people visit each spring and fall, and this little stretch of Highway 237 becomes a big deal. It's also home of the Junk Gypsy World Headquarters, a family business that specializes in turning other people's trash into treasure. They took this small thing, this one passion, and turned it into an empire and a really fun reality TV show. In their words, junking is a way of life, and garage sales are our rodeo drive. It's not just what we do, it's who we are. And their story resonates so deeply with me because isn't that what we all want out of life? To take our small passions and offerings and allow God to turn them into something bigger than we dared dream was possible. Welcome to Round Top, Texas, home of the Junk Gypsy World Headquarters. We're inside their store right now for session one, and what I love is how they use all these small things that other people may not even notice. And so that's really what we're going to talk about in session one today, is just how God uses just our small acts of daily faithfulness to transform them into something big that He uses in ways that we couldn't imagine. D.L. Moody has a great quote that I've always loved, and what he says is there are many of us that are willing to do great things for the Lord, but there are few of us that are willing to do little things. And I think God is a God who really values the small things. He's a God that says that not even a sparrow falls to the ground without Him noticing it. And so how much more valuable are all these little pieces of our life that He's putting together? And so I want us to start today by looking at a story to see what Jesus does with small things and the small things we offer. And so we're going to be looking in John 6. And it's where Jesus feeds the 5,000. And it talks about that He's crossed over the shore of Galilee and a crowd is gathered and it's time for lunch. And so they don't know what to do because, you know, this was before the days where everybody could just go to the food court and there wasn't a Chili's where everybody could go and get baby back ribs. And so they had to figure out what they were going to do. And so it says, Jesus looked up and He saw a great crowd coming toward Him. And He said to Philip, "Where should we buy bread for these people to eat?" He asked this only to test Him, for He already had in mind what He was going to do. And Philip answered Him, 8 months' wages wouldn't buy enough bread for each one to have a bite. Another one of His disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, spoke up and said, "There is a boy with 5 small barley loaves and 2 small fish, but how far will that go among so many?" And Jesus said, "Have the people sit down." And I'm sure so many of you have heard the story and you know what happens next. I mean, spoiler alert if you don't, but Jesus turns these 2 small loaves and these fish into enough to feed 5,000. And I think what's so interesting about that story is anytime I've heard it told over the years, which has been numerous times from being little bitty in Sunday school, is you hear about the miracle of Jesus being able to turn the fish into enough to feed 5,000. And you hear about the disciples and how they doubted what Jesus was going to be able to do. You hear about the little boy and how he was so faithful to offer his lunch. But I'm going to tell you, in all my years of listening to that story, you know who never gets a shout out? The mom who packed that lunch. And you think that mom that day probably was desperate like all of us, where you do that thing where you're like, what do I have that's not stale or moldy? Have I been to the store? Is it socially acceptable to just send my child to lunch with like 2 carrot sticks and a pack of chocolate chip cookies? But what she had that day were 5 small loaves and 2 fish, and she threw them in a basket. And I'm sure she pushed her boy out the door and said, "Have a good day." And what she never could have imagined is what God was going to do that day with that small offering and that little lunch that she had packed for her boy. And I think what's so interesting is I bet that mom, she had done that a million times, that her boy was running off to do whatever he does during the day, play with the neighborhood kids, go work with his dad, whatever it was. And so she just was doing what she did every single day, like so many of us do. She just packed a lunch. She just did what God called her to do and was faithful to her family and did what she was supposed to do that day. That mom that day, she wasn't wringing her hands like so many of us do, going, is this God's will that I pack this lunch today? How is God going to use this lunch? Does this lunch matter in the whole scheme of eternity? She was just doing what was put in front of her. She was just faithful in that one daily thing. That's what the next thing was that for her to do, was to pack that lunch for her boy and to get him off to where he needed to be. And she wasn't worried about, can God use this? Does it matter in the scheme of eternity? How will this lunch affect people? She just did what was there for her to do. I think the other interesting thing for that mom is too, is you think if you are a mom, there's so many of us that we're constantly telling our kids, like, be kind, share, be nice to the new kid, all that stuff. And sometimes you just think, I don't even think they're listening to me, mainly because 90% of the time they're not even listening to you. But there are those momentary glances that sometimes we get as a parent where we're like, oh my gosh, they were actually paying attention to that. And I think in addition to packing that lunch, what she got to see that day is that her son offered his lunch up. And for a mom, what's better than that, than to go, okay, my kid is actually paying attention, all this stuff that I say over and over and over again. And listen, they're never going to remember to get their shoes from the living room to their bedroom because that's too hard. That's shoe math, and that's too hard to get your shoes from the living room to the bedroom for a kid. Their mind doesn't process that. But in that moment, she was able to say, okay, he got the part where I said, be kind, share, offer what you have. And I think so much of her son knowing that lesson was probably what she had shown, because he saw that he has this mom that packs this lunch every single day and takes care of the small things every day. And so I think you see where I'm going with this story about the mom and the lunch and all those things, is that there's all these small daily pieces of our life that God can use in such a big way when we allow him to, and when we just show up for where he's called us to be. And we worry so much. I think we can get so concerned about, what's God's will for my life? Am I supposed to do this thing or that thing? What should I do? What should this look like? Is this big enough? Does this matter? And I think ultimately we're in God's will. What that really looks like is when we wake up every day with a willingness to say, God, I'm going to go where you lead me to go today. What do you have for me today? Where can I be faithful to you today? This family that you've given me, this job that you've given me, this life that you've given me, where can I show up and be faithful today? And it may not be the glamorous thing, it's the faithful thing. Because sometimes, let's be honest, just showing up and living a life where you just do the thing that you're supposed to do can sometimes look boring. They don't make movies about great marriages necessarily. They don't make movies about just raising good kids. But those are all the small pieces of our life that God uses. They don't make movies about just showing up for work every day. But those are the things that matter in the whole scheme of things, is where has God put you and where can he use all those small pieces of your life to make a difference? Life to me is what's happening all around us. All these little small things that sometimes we don't notice, and it's happening all around us. But sometimes I think we can get so consumed. And I used to be like this, where I'm waiting for the big moments. You know, it's like when you grow up, you're waiting for, you know, when I graduate from high school, when I get out of college, when I get married, when I have kids, when I finally get my dream job, when we finally buy the bigger house or have the newer car or all that stuff. And we're just waiting for like the next big thing. And meanwhile, life is happening all around us every day. And there's a thing, you know, you hear this thing where it's like, life is about the moments that take our breath away. But I'm like, but what about just living our lives in every moment that we have a breath? What if we just wake up and enjoy the small things? Because what I've learned happens is you can have these great big moments that happen, and your hair can look like Connie Britton's on Friday Night Lights for like one day, or you can say a joke, and in that moment, you can be like as funny as Tina Fey, which is like one of my life goals. But then that moment's over, and you're like, well, that was nice. What's next? And so I think we miss so much of the daily things that God wants to do. And I think God is such a God, and I know that God is a God that uses the small. He used 12 ordinary men to change the world. When you really think about what that means, those men weren't anything special. They were fishermen. They were just normal men that he found, but he saw something in them and said, you know what? I see their hearts, and these are the men I'm going to use to change the world. I think when we live life in a way where we enjoy all the little moments, it's when we wake up and go, you know what, I've got breath in my lungs, the sun's out today, my kids actually got off to school today with like both their shoes on and a lunch packed. And so we just value those accomplishments and go, you know what, this is where life is. We have a neighborhood pool that we go to, and there's a concession stand where the teenager kids work in the summertime. And I was standing there one day, and I'd placed my order, and they were all talking among themselves. And somebody said, man, what are you doing tonight? And the other guy looked at him, and he said, you know what? It's Saturday night. I got a new pair of shoes. The possibilities are endless. And I thought, what if we all live like that? What if we just said, you know what? Saturday night, I got a new pair of shoes, and the possibilities are endless. What can God do with that? When we just live with that enthusiasm of like, you know what my life is? The possibilities are endless. I'm just gonna live in this moment, and I'm gonna embrace where I am right now, good or bad, and I'm just gonna find the joy in the small places that God has for me. They're the small pieces of our life that God is turning into a treasure, sometimes when we're not even paying attention. In our front yard, we have this orange tree. My daughter begged my husband to plant an orange tree in our front yard.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.